Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the 35th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. Our only item of business this morning is the consideration of a statutory instrument, the Winter Heating Assistance Low Income Scotland Regulations 2023. At last week's committee meeting, ahead of our consideration of the regulations, we took evidence from Energy Action Scotland and the Scottish Commission on Social Security on winter heating payments. I welcome Ben McPherson, MSP, Minister for Social Security and Local Government. And I also welcome officials Daniel Blakey, Solicitor, Scottish Government, who is joining us in the room today. And Owen Allen, Winter Heating Benefits Policy Manager, and Angela Keane, Service Manager, Winter Benefits, Scottish Government, who are joining us remotely. Hello all. Thank you for attending this meeting. A few points to mention about the format of the meeting just before we begin. Angela and Owen online, please allow our broadcasting colleagues just a few seconds to turn your microphone on before you start to speak if the Minister wishes to bring you in. For our members attending remotely, please wait until I say your name before speaking. And colleagues in the room should indicate to myself or the clerk if they wish to come in and ask a supplementary question. Members online should use the chat box or WhatsApp group. The instrument is laid under the affirmative procedure, which means that the Parliament must approve it before it comes into force. Following this evidence session, the committee will be invited at the next agenda item to consider a motion to approve the instrument. I remind everyone that Scottish Government officials can speak under this item, but not in the debate that follows. So I'll now invite the Minister to make a short opening statement.
Good morning, Convener. Colleagues, thank you for the opportunity to discuss with you the draft Winter Heating Assistance Low Income Scotland regulations today. These regulations will introduce our 13th Scottish benefit called Winter Heating Payment. This will support around 400,000 people, replacing the UK Government's cold weather payment. In contrast to cold weather payments, which are dependent on certain weather conditions, winter heating payment will be an annual, reliable £50 benefit delivered by Social Security Scotland beginning in February. Our approach will differ from that of the DWP because to receive a single payment of the DWP's cold weather payment, someone must be living in an area where the average of the mean daily temperature for 7 consecutive days is 0 degrees or below, identified through weather stations which often do not represent local conditions. By comparison, for winter heating payment, we have removed the requirement for any period of a specific temperature being reached. And instead, we will provide stability to people on low incomes who are less likely to be able to afford additional heating costs during the winter. We know that the cost of living crisis has had a significant impact on everyone, but those who are likely to feel the increase in energy prices the most are those with the lowest incomes and the highest need for additional warmth. That includes older people, disabled people, and households with young children. Our new winter heating payment targets these groups, ensuring they receive a reliable contribution towards their winter heating expenses and do not have to hope for periods of cold weather to be sustained for 7 days just to trigger a payment, as is the case with cold weather payments. Indeed, between 2015-16 and 2021-22, an average of only £8.3 million was spent on cold weather payments in Scotland, supporting on average around 185,000 people each year. By comparison, we anticipate that our reliable £50 winter heating payment will provide at least £20 million to, as I've said, 400,000 people every year. We face challenging times and we are working within a largely fixed budget in Scotland. And investing £20 million each year is significantly more than the corresponding level of funding we are forecast to receive from the UK Government under the block grant adjustment, again representing our principles that social security is an investment in people and can contribute to tackling poverty. For context, in 4 of the last 11 years, low-income households received less than £1 million from cold weather payments to help with their heating bills. And of course, as a Scottish Government, as well as the £20 million we have allocated for winter heating payment, we are also spending tens of millions of pounds, hundreds of millions of pounds, on devolved social security, including our Scottish Child Payment, Child Winter Heating Assistance, Carers Allowance Supplement, and other benefits that are only available for people in Scotland. Convener, my officials and I are also very grateful to the DWP for their collaboration in delivering winter heating payment as part of our joint delivery of our devolved social security programme. Our ability to meet our target of beginning payments in February is based on DWP providing the right data at the right time to the Scottish Government. To ensure payments can begin in February, it is critical that DWP maintain their commitment to providing data to Social Security Scotland by the 31st of January to allow us to conclude our internal assurance of the 400,000 records. That's really important, and we continue to work closely with DWP to ensure a safe and secure transition. Lastly, members will be aware that the draft regulations were referred to the Scottish Commission on Social Security in June, and we received their report in August. The Scottish Government response to their recommendations was laid in Parliament on the 16th of November, along with the final draft of the regulations. As always, I am extremely grateful to the Scottish Commission on Social Security for its scrutiny and recommendations. I welcome the opportunity to be with you today and to take any questions as part of your consideration of these important regulations. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. We'll now move straight on to questions from members, and our questions will be directed to you, but you're of course welcome to bring in any official. So I will move straight to questions from our Deputy Convener, Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Convener. Since last week's meeting, we've had some really helpful information from SPICE around which weather stations have triggered cold weather payments in the past and how many times. Six of the seven areas with the highest fuel poverty are in my region of the Highlands and Islands, but some of those areas, like Stornoway, haven't triggered a cold weather payment in many years. And when they have in Wick, Lerwick and Kirkwall, it tends to be one trigger a year, despite the challenges that we know exist there. Is winter heating payment then going to be a move in the right direction in tackling fuel poverty?
Thank you. And I think those are some important points that get to the heart of both the weakness of the cold weather payment system, in that it's unreliable and dependent on, as I said in my opening statement, the weather dropping below 0 degrees Celsius for a 7 consecutive day period. And that, combined with the fact that the weather stations don't necessarily capture the feelings of cold and the experience of cold weather that many communities are subject to. For example, issues like wind chill are not factored into the considerations. And yes, I mean, I think the fact that Lerwick and Shetland has only had three triggers of cold weather payments in the last 10 years. You also mentioned other areas in your region. For example, Wick has only had two since 2010-11. So that shows the weakness of the current system. What we are seeking to do, of course, moving away from cold weather payments and into winter heating assistance, is to provide that support in a reliable way. Two areas, particularly, of course, with regard to the constituents you represent, this will be an improved position. But also, there are areas of Scotland that experience fuel poverty, where the weather is perhaps not quite as cold, but also cold. And what we have sought to do is make a change here that helps low-income households in a more comprehensive way. Of course, increasing the amount of people who, on average, will benefit from support from this winter benefit from around 185,000, as I said, to 400,000. So an increase of over 200,000 people receiving the support, but also the fact that it will be reliable. And that is the key change that we're making today.
Yeah, on the point around reliability, looking at the likes of Abbey Moore, who this winter might only have triggered one or maybe no cold weather payments, but in other years could be looking at three or four, is there extra help available to people in these places if there is a very bad winter?
I appreciate that point, and I think the fact that The way the question was correctly worded there around if and should demonstrates the fact of why we need to go to a reliable position for people. But I do appreciate that, and also Mr. Balfour asked this question in the chamber just yesterday around areas who under the cold weather payments system, if there was a prolonged period of several instances of seven consecutive days, which is unusual, would have received support from the cold weather payment system then. But of course in Scotland we also have our fuel insecurity fund, which we have doubled, and we would encourage people to engage with that support. Also we have the different support mechanisms that are detailed in our cost of living website campaign, and would encourage people to look at that package of support and access all of the support that they're entitled to. And of course, many of the households that would have received cold weather payment in such a scenario, if the weather was extreme to the extent that cold weather payments would have been initiated, a lot of those households will be also receiving additional support from the Scottish Government through the Social Security system. So, for example, through Scottish Child Payment, also through the Carers Allowance Supplement, potentially their household. So there is a lot of additional support that these households rightly are receiving from the Scottish Government.
That's convener. That's Minister.
Thank you. We'll now move online to questions from James Dornan.
Good morning, Minister. I don't know who or what higher power I've upset, but my heating has been off for the last 24 hours. And no immediate sign of a thaw to the pipes. Now, I appreciate that I, quite rightly, would not qualify for this benefit, but given I'm sure there will be a number of my constituents going through the same experience right now, when I called my factory, they said they'd hundreds of these calls over the last 2 days. Could you tell me, A, when is the last time that my constituents would have received, or Glasgow City itself, last received the cold weather payments? And B, would my constituents now benefit from the winter heating payment?
So, thank you. So, the first of all, the challenge is that the relevant weather station for most of Glasgow and some of Renfrewshire is, well, for Renfrewshire and most of Glasgow is Bishopton. But I would also take this opportunity to emphasise that as part of the weakness in the cold weather payment system is that the weather stations relate to certain postcodes, and it's not based on local authority area, and there is challenge around that. But the Bishopton weather station is the one that serves Glasgow to the largest extent. There was a cold weather payment in 2021. £25, and in 18-19 there was £25. 17-18 there were two, which would have been £50. So in the period since 2011-12 until last year, your constituents who are served by the weather station at Bishopton would have only received £100. Whereas, of course, under our system, they would have received £50 each year if that had been in place. So I think that demonstrates for many low-income households that they will be better off under the winter heating payment system that we are seeking to introduce and asking committee to approve today than they would have been under the cold weather payment system.
Thanks for that answer. Is it possible the reason that most respondents to the consultation, I think it was 76%, agreed with breaking the link to the cold weather, precisely because a large group of people who could have done with this support have previously missed out? And maybe the Minister can outline how the feedback from stakeholders influenced the development of the policy. For example, was this inherent unfairness in the CEWP the primary reason that the Scottish Government decided to break the link with cold weather?
Thank you. Just to correct the record, I should have said that there was also one payment in 14-15, so another £25 there. So apologise to the committee So, but again, the amount of support that would have been paid through the winter heating payment system would have been £50 reliably per year, which would have accumulated to significantly more. The engagement with stakeholders others, I will bring Owen in a minute, if I may, convener. Of course, the Scottish Government consulted both with more widely, and we really appreciated the feedback and contributions of all those who engaged with that consultation. And there was a clear view from the consultation, and also through our experience panels, which of course Social Security Scotland consult on the work that we're doing consistently. That breaking the link with cold weather was very much preferred because of the unreliability of not knowing whether support would be available and the fact that the 7 consecutive day requirement often means that there may be temperatures that are at freezing 0 degrees Celsius or below for example 6 days. But then on the 7th, not so. And that would mean that people wouldn't get that extra support under the cold weather payment system. So breaking the link with cold weather and the issues around the fact that the weather stations do not... The reliance on the weather stations and the placement of the weather stations geographically means that there are places that... Are not able to get the cold weather payment even when the weather for people feels and is cold. The way that that's organised logistically just feels unjust for people, and that is why we're seeking, and I think it is unjust, and that is why we're seeking to make the change to a reliable payment. Owen, do you want to say a bit more about the engagement that we undertook? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. Good morning. Just to reiterate what the Minister said, the vast majority of respondents through our public consultation agreed with the proposal to move away from a weather-dependent payment towards a payment that was more universal and certain. This was echoed in our Social Security Experience Panel survey, which was run at the same time, asking people with lived experience of cold weather payments and the benefit system, similar questions. We also carried out extensive engagement with our stakeholder reference group, and again, the views were echoed there. In terms of how that was taken into consideration, or the overall stakeholder engagement was taken into consideration during the development of the policy, it fed back in terms of the timing of the qualifying week and the fact that that was moved closer to the time of payment after the consultation period, and obviously we'll continue to work with stakeholders moving forward once the benefit has been launched.
Thank you for that.
If I may elaborate as well, that of course the most respondents to the consultation, 76%, agreed with breaking the link to cold weather, and I mean even if we reflect on last winter, you can understand why, because in 21-22. DWP estimates show that cold weather payments were only triggered on 6 occasions at only 4 of the 27 Scottish weather stations, and that resulted in payments of only £325,000 in total to approximately 11,000 individuals. So if we'd had winter heating payment last year, it would have been £20 million of investment compared with £325,000, and also it would have supported the 400,000 individuals in comparison to 11,000. So I just think that's, of course, the unreliability of cold weather payments means it's different each year, but I think by comparison to look at last year compared with what we'll be able to do this year should these regulations pass is worth considering. Thanks.
Thank you very much, James, and thank you, Minister. I'll bring Pam Duncan-Glancy in now, thanks.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister, and to your officials as well, and thanks for joining us. I won't rehearse some of the arguments that we've just heard about the differentials, but what I will say is that for the additional people who are getting money, I think it's very important for us all to remember that that is a pound a week. It is barely going to scratch the surface, and Energy Action Scotland said last week that it would be a finger in the dam in terms of fuel poverty. So I think we really need to bear that in mind when we're describing something that has also been described as ill-conceived benefit, aghast that it has ever been launched. I genuinely share that concern. So last week, Energy Action Scotland told us that during winter 2020-2021, at typical consumption rates for energy, the cold weather payment provided 56 days of heat. A £50 payment to the same community at the current rates provides only 7 days of heat. Across winter 23-24, the £50 payment will provide only 6 days of heat, as I've said. The offer is not going to be enough for people in need. You say you've retained the ability to legislate for additional payments for those groups should the need arise. How do you determine need? And how do we know that you'll do this, given that when you gave a commitment about doubling the carers' allowance supplement, that never materialised?
You finished, Ms. Glancy? Yeah, thank you. I appreciate the questions, and I listened to Fraser Scott's evidence from last week as well. And we have deliberately built in the capacity in these regulations in future years to be able to pay a higher sum if the government was financially able to. That would require a change to the regulations, another set of amending regulations, but also the ability to pay two payments in winter, if that was the determination of the government at that time, or more. But that would require two scans from the DWP of the data available in order to implement that. So I've deliberately built in flexibility to be able to pay more and more often in the future if that was feasibly possible and financially possible. And that the challenge, of course, for all of government is for this financial year, members are aware, given the two statements made by the Deputy First Minister and Acting Finance Secretary on how challenging the budget is this year. And of course, in future years, the budget the budget for the next financial year will be announced to Parliament this afternoon. Members will know that. I cannot comment on that at this point. So the government has a very strong record of seeking to do more with Scottish Social Security where and when it can. Of course, we unfortunately haven't been able to pay an additional carers allowance supplement this year, but we have, of course, continued to pay the additional the carers allowance supplement, which isn't available elsewhere in the UK. Of course, we have increased the Scottish Child Payment by 150%. We are delivering child winter heating assistance that has been paid. So there are a range of supports from the Scottish Government that are over and above what people receive elsewhere in the UK, that are utilising the social security system to provide additional support to people who need it. And we are always looking at ways we can do more. But that is, of course, within, to a very, very large extent, a restricted budget that we have to operate within. And that's the reality of the situation that we face in these financial times, and with the limited powers and limited resources of the Scottish Government. So would I like winter heating assistance to be a higher amount? Of course I would. But we also have to operate within the budgets that we have. For £50 will be more, as I said, for many, many individuals than they would have received under the cold weather payment system. And we're pleased to be able to give them that additional support with appreciation of the challenging times that people are experiencing.
Thank you. And for the people who get it, I'm sure the £50, which again I will say is a pound a week against the rising energy costs, I genuinely share concerns that it is a finger in a dam, but I'm sure they will appreciate the pound. You also, Minister, noted that weather stations don't reflect everywhere in Scotland, and I share that concern, and you'll be aware that last week so did witnesses. What other weather-related options did you consider? Did you look at absolute temperature? And you've said that it would be administratively burdensome. So can you set out what conversations you've had with the Met Office?
So on the latter point, I will bring Owen in again in terms of engagement with the Met Office. I should say that, you know, I appreciate the point around if you were to isolate the £50 support as if that was the only thing the Scottish Government was doing to provide additional financial resource, then I appreciate the arguments that the government should always be looking to do more. But it is important to also consider that the Scottish Government is providing tens, hundreds of millions of pounds of additional social security support that's not available in Scotland. And many of the individuals who will receive winter heating payment will also be receiving other support from the Scottish Government. We have doubled the fuel insecurity fund as well. So there is a lot of other financial resource and support that's available to people. And I think it's important to see winter heating payment in that wider context, because it's a contribution to the costs that people are experiencing, along with other support. In terms of the question on delivery, we as I said, I've moved away from weather dependent approach, because we know the difference between some areas and location of weather stations, which could trigger a cold weather payment, has been a source of frustration for people previously, and I think we understand that collectively. And the exclusive reliance on temperature rather than other factors such as wind chill, as I mentioned to the Deputy Convener, has also made some people feel that they were not being treated fairly, and indeed island communities have particularly lost out under the cold weather payment system. But retaining any weather dependency aspect when introducing winter heating payment would require a new agreement to be reached with the DWP and the Met Office, and would be much more technically complex to develop and test, and would be an administratively burdensome scheme for Social Security Scotland to deliver. So I think it's important to be upfront about that, whereas a flat rate payment will be more simple to deliver and administer. But more importantly, it will provide a guaranteed payment to those most vulnerable who have been identified as needing additional support. The guaranteed payment, the reliability of winter heating payment, will be the most significant change that will make a difference for many, as well as, of course, the extended number of people who will receive support by, we project, over 200,000 more people will receive support. Owen, do you want to say anything more about the Met Office, please?
I'll just make one point, Minister. I think you covered the majority of the main points. During the policy development of winter heating payment, we did engage with the Met Office on other ways of changing cold weather payment. The weather dependency aspect of cold weather payment is the most complex aspect of the eligibility. The conclusion of our discussions with Met Office were that adding anything further or changing anything further in terms of weather, adding in wind chill, feels like temperature, adds significant complexity to how that's calculated and identified by the Met Office. And obviously, it's opposite of the approach that we've taken to simplify the benefit itself to ensure it's delivered quicker.
Thanks, Wayne.
Thank you.
Do you have no further questions, Pam?
Not in this area, no.
Okay,
thanks.
Thank you. I'll move now to questions from Jeremy Balfour, to be followed by Faisal Chowdhury online.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister, and to your officers, officials. Can I just follow up that just question from my colleague, Pam Duncan Clancy? How many meetings did you have with the Met Office, and how many meetings did you have with DWP to discuss other methods of doing it?
Well, again, I'll bring Owen in a minute, because, of course, engagement would take place more at official level. The development of winter heating assistance in terms of the decisions that were made was before I was appointed as Minister, so it wouldn't be have been me personally, but I'll bring Owen in to discuss official engagement, and perhaps you can also refer to any engagement that Ms Somerville undertook as Cabinet Secretary. Owen?
As far as I'm aware, there was no engagement at ministerial level. There were multiple multiple meetings at official level, initially pre-COVID, and then late in 2021.
Could I just clarify for you, Minister, was that meetings with the Met Office and with DWP, or just with the Met Office?
Owen, do you want to answer that on behalf of Mr Balfour, please? Thanks.
Apologies. That was specifically with the Met Office at official level.
Then can I clarify again for you, Minister, how many meetings did officials have with DWP officials to discuss how this would work?
Owen, if you could answer that, Mr Balfour, if you're not able to identify how many meetings, perhaps you can allude to approximately the number of meetings.
I wouldn't have the specific number to hand. There's constant engagement between Scottish Government officials and DWP officials across policy and programme. So the specific number I wouldn't have to hand.
I mean, I should say, if I may, Mr Balfour, that engagement between the Scottish Government at official level and the DWP has been strong and constructive on this. The delivery of this benefit. I mean, I alluded in my opening remarks how important it is for us to get the scan that we require from DWP before the end of January in order to deliver it. We had wished that we could have got that scan earlier in January, but we also appreciate and understand the demands on colleagues in the DWP at the moment in terms of delivering the cost of living support. Which is a significant undertaking for the DWP. So there's an understanding of the priorities and needs of both governments at the moment to deliver support, and we're working to do that in a constructive way.
I'm grateful for that, Minister. In the policy memorandum set out at the start of this policy, one of the things the Scottish Government committed to was to leave nobody behind and to leave nobody worse off. Now, the figures that we have from Spice and the figures that you have been using show that there will be people who are going to be worse off because of this introduction of this new benefit. Why has that happened, and would you like to apologise to those individuals this morning?
Well, there could... I can appreciate the question in that cold weather payment has, in certain areas, initiated... more than two payments in a winter in parts of Scotland not on a consistent basis, because there's nothing consistent about cold weather payment. That's one of the inherent weaknesses in it. But I appreciate there are areas that have received support from cold weather payments that exceeds £50 in certain years. But we don't know what the weather is going to be like even in those places in winters to come. I would encourage those who may in certain weather conditions have received more than £50 under the cold weather payment in certain places, I would encourage them to utilise the other support from the Scottish Government, like the Fuel Insecurity Fund, for example. But I think it is important to recognise that overall, hundreds of thousands of more people will benefit from the winter heating payment than have done under the cold weather payment system.
But do you accept the evidence that we heard last week that there will be people this year who will be worse off than they would have been in previous years?
We don't know this year, Mr Balfour, and I don't mean to be flippant or anything around that, but there's been one... this week would have initiated a cold weather payment in certain places in Scotland, because there's been seven consecutive days of weather at 0 degrees Celsius or below, but we don't know if there'll be another 2 weeks of that in winter in Scotland, even in those places. So I appreciate on the evidence last week and on the stats, that there are places that have historically, in years past, some years past, not all years, some years past, received more than £50. But there's no guarantee that that would happen this year or the year after or the year after that or the year after that. Even in those places, although, you know, I appreciate looking at the weather and analysis, it could be likely, and I accept that. But overall, as I said, tens of thousands of more people will benefit from winter heating payment than did under the cold weather payment system.
Thank you. My final question, Ms. Ailey, Minister, is you started with a blank piece of paper, or, well, your predecessor started with a blank piece of paper in regard to designing a scheme. Now, I accept there were faults within the DW scheme, and I think you've highlighted those, but there's clearly the system here has got criticism from a number of the third sector charities around it. I would be interested to know, did you look at any other scheme of deciding how to get a payment? And so, for example, rather than taking 7 days as a limit for having at a certain temperature, did you look at, say, 3 days or 4 days of looking at that temperature? And why, in the end, did you come up with a scheme that possibly, on certain years, will leave a number of people in the coldest parts of Scotland less well off?
So I'll bring Owen in a minute in terms of the history of the considerations. I think it's important to recognise that the considerations around this benefit were, of course, also impacted by the pandemic period. And also, there were, because we have a work programme that we want to fulfil to meet Parliament's expectations and also those of the public, and our ambition and determination to devolve social security in a way that's, yes, safe and secure, but also as expedient as possible within that. But more importantly, there was a recognition that the cold weather payment, and I should say that, of course, I would want to recognise that for the, with regard to my answer to your former question, I would want to recognise that I do appreciate that in around the Braemar station, there have been most years and initiations of several cold weather payments, and I recognise that fact and do appreciate that. But with regard to the considerations of your question in terms of what considerations were there around the delivery of this benefit, I think the overarching recognition was the unreliability of it, the fact it didn't guarantee low-income families support, low-income household support, and that there was a need to build in a consistency of having a measure that helped those who need assistance in different parts of Scotland with a reliable payment to help them with their heating assistance. Not the only payment, because there, of course, are other supports, but a reliable payment within that to provide that support. Owen, do you want to come in on the considerations in the development of this benefit?
Thank you, Minister. There were multiple different options considered during the development of the policy. I'll just reiterate what I said earlier in terms of retaining any kind of weather dependency aspect and making changes to that to change the number of days a cold weather event is recorded over the temperature, what's considered alongside the temperature, such as wind chill and rain, would add significant complexity to how the benefit is delivered.
Thanks, Owen.
Thank you. Thank you, Minister.
Thank you. Can we move now to questions from Faisal Chowdhury?
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, colleagues and the team. Last week, the committee was given evidence of the rates of the fuel poverty across Scotland. Is the move to break the link to the weather not going to further disadvantage some of the already fuel poor areas in the Highlands and Island, for example, Minister.
A lot of this already, so I'd be grateful if you could keep the response to this quite brief, as we're running low on time.
I appreciate the sentiment of the points raised by Mr. Trudy. I would refer him to my previous answers to Mr. Balfour. That's helpful for experience.
Thank you very much.
You content with that, Mr. Trudy?
Yeah, I'm good with that. Yeah, thank you. When you're online, sometimes you miss a few things. But thank you very much.
Thank you. So we'll move now on to theme two. And I would just ask members and the minister if you could please keep questions and answers quite brief, as we are running quite low on time. Theme two, I'll move first to questions from Paul McLennan.
Yeah, thank you, convener, and good morning, minister. I'll kind of keep the questions to kind of what concentrated on last week as well. In terms of this, you've obviously mentioned about the other schemes that are there to help people, both obviously within the Scottish Government and within the UK as well. I suppose the question for me is, how do we maximise the opportunity that they're aware of that, in terms of that, to make sure that they are aware of the winter heating payment, but also other benefits that are out there? I know there was a scheme that was raised during the week, obviously trying to say around about making people aware, but generally ongoing, what can we do in that regard?
Yeah. Such an important question. Well, first of all, in terms of winter heating assistance, winter heating payment rather, people won't need to be aware; they'll just get it. We'll write Social Security Scotland will write to them, and they'll get it. But of course, we collectively, and we've discussed this in a very constructive and helpful way as a committee, as a parliament, and the public discourse is very engaged on this. In how do we raise awareness of what support's available more generally? And of course, the Scottish Government's hosting website of bringing listing all the support that's available to people and encouraging to utilise it is something that we should disseminate widely and raise awareness of within all regions and constituencies of Scotland. And I know that's happening, and I appreciate members' engagement on that. And of course, the Government, working with local authorities and the third sector and other bodies, is constantly trying to raise awareness of what support is available. In terms of making sure that people are aware of the Fuel Insecurity Fund, is something that we should all be doing, as well as also, of course, appreciating that there are payments that have already been initiated. I mean, child winter heating assistance has gone out from Social Security Scotland to around 25,000 households. So that's additional support that's been paid just in recent weeks. Also, there's of course the other supports available that do require an application. So on the Scottish Government side, we continue to raise awareness of the various family benefits in particular that require application. Scottish Child Payment, the response has been remarkable, and the number of applications has been extraordinary, and the Social Security Scotland is working to deliver and pay those as quickly as they can. But also I would cite as well, of course, that there is currently a campaign underway to encourage people to make sure that they're applying for pension credit from the UK Government. Yep. And I would take this opportunity to commend DWP for the proactive way in which they are encouraging people to undertake, to uptake pension credit. And of course, that's helpful because it's also a benefit that unlocks some Social Security Scotland benefits. So there's a range of work underway, and I would encourage all parliamentarians, everyone who has a network, and in their personal, if there are people listening, personal networks, whether that's word of mouth or online or otherwise, to just continue to raise awareness of what support's available, because you know, this government absolutely wants to get every pound of support that people are entitled to them, particularly at this time.
Thanks, Minister. Just for brevity, that's fine. That's fine for me, convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Paul. We'll move back to Faisal Chowdhury, who is joining us online.
Thank you. I think we did talk about it in the last one, the Operating of the £50 payment, is there any planned framework for this? Or winter heating payments? I think Minister did talk on the last when Mr Balfour asked that question, but is there any plan for operating this £50 plan?
So, again, an important point, and of course, considerations around operating are for the budget process. Of course, there will be a budget statement this afternoon, and I'm sure members can appreciate why I can't comment on this or any of the devolved benefits that are within our discretion in terms of operating.
Absolutely. Thank you very much. I'll wait for the budget report.
Thank you. Thank you. Move now to Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Convener. The rate, as we've discussed, is at £50 in the current rate of heating. That would probably heat a house for six days, as I said earlier. Can you set out why specifically £50? And in line with costs, the payment should be £125. What would you say to people who are struggling with their bills on the basis of that just now?
So, as I alluded earlier, following the consultation, we did consider increasing the payment to £25 and £100. However, this would increase the forecast annual expenditure from £20 million to £30 million and £40 million, respectively. And we're just not able to finance that within this financial year. As members know, the Scottish Government budget is under significant pressure with regard to this financial year. But we have, of course, made a choice to invest over and above the corresponding level of funding that we forecast to receive from the UK Government with regard to cold weather payments. But this limits our scope for additional increases to the value or frequency of payments because of the nature of our very, very significantly fixed budget. I would say as well that, of course, £50 is, on average, more than what people would have received from the cold weather payment. So the amount that people would often... the majority of people would receive from the cold weather payment was £25, so we've doubled that to £50.
Okay, thank you. In the interest of brevity, I'll leave it there. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Pam. We'll now move on to theme three, which is qualifying date and payment date. I'd actually like to come in with one of my own questions on this. One of the things that was raised a lot last week, and one of the things that... slightly concerning was the payment date in terms of that February date. So obviously the Minister has already alluded to the increased number of people who are going to benefit from this, and that is a hugely positive thing. But in terms of that February date, that does seem a little bit late in the winter. So could the Minister outline how we came to that February date, please?
Thank you. And an important question, and I do understand the focus on this. So, during our consultation, we did engage with several stakeholders as well as people with lived experience on of cold weather payments through our Social Security Scotland experience panels, as I mentioned. And we do appreciate that there was different views on when would be the best time for this benefit to be delivered. However, there have been arguments that from different consultation feedback that we've had, and also considerations more widely, that it can be colder in January and February, and also it could be helpful for people who get quarterly bills that the largest of these tend to land with people in February. However, I know that there are differing opinions on this, and this is something we will consider ahead of future years, because I know there are those who have expressed a preference for such a payment to be made earlier in the winter. And I have committed to review that ahead of delivery next year and in future years. And the regulations deliberately state that we deliver this benefit in winter to create that flexibility so we can consider when would be the optimum time. In terms of this year, we do have a congested delivery landscape. Of course, I talked in answer to Mr. Balfour earlier about the fact that DWP are also under pressure delivering their payments of additional support, although I'm in no way suggesting that DWP have determined our timetable. We set our timetable for February because of what I've said previously, but we also had to consider the fact that we were delivering child winter heating assistance and needing to deliver that payment. We were delivering carers allowance supplement and had to consider that payment. We've of course rolled out adult disability payment this year, and that has increased the demands on the agency, and also of course significantly launched the second phase of Scottish Child Payment on the 14th of November. So we had to consider how we deliver benefit. We always have to consider how we deliver benefits safely and securely and reliably. And we have to, the agency has to, in this instance with winter heating payment, deliver a new benefit that where we provide enough time to ensure that we have developed the capacity to process the 400,000 cases when we receive the data scan from the DWP, and also to make sure that essential system testing is completed prior to commencing any payments. So there were a wide range of considerations that went in to why this instance the payment will be made from February. But as I said, I have committed to considering if and when we would want to change that for next year or future years. And I've listened attentively and to the feedback on that, and appreciate the evidence that the committee has heard.
Thank you very much, Minister, for providing that clarity, and important to know that flexibility is there. I'll now move to questions from Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Good morning to your officials as well. And I think on that point, Convener, you raised, it is concerning because there doesn't seem to be flexibility. And from what we've heard, you know, Scots living in some of the coldest communities in Scotland are going to lose out. And I think that's deeply concerning. Braemar has recorded minus 15 this week. Today, as we speak, it's minus 2. So do you accept that these rural communities are going to lose out, and these payments aren't going to be even in their bank till potentially February? So I wanted to specifically ask, why is there not that flexibility? DWP can pay within 14 days for this money to be put out now.
So as I said, because we are increasing the amount of people who will receive support from the Scottish Government, is a large data scan that we need to receive from DWP, and we're working collegiately with DWP on receiving that data. We then need to receive that data, assurance check it, make sure it's do all the appropriate system testing and system alignment that has to happen to deliver a benefit, and then deliver it from February. And DWP have committed to provide that scan to us before the 31st of January, and we're grateful for that because we need that scan in order to deliver it. I think the comparison with the 14 days from cold weather payment is not appreciative of the fact that we are initiating this benefit this year, and there will be flexibility in future years, as I said, if we wanted to change the payment to a different juncture in the calendar. So to November or December or January, but that would also be contingent on agreement with DWP that we would receive the scan in those years in advance of being able to deliver that payment. And I'm not saying DWP wouldn't, but we would have to agree that with them in a collegiate manner. So, as I said, that flexibility has been built in. I mean, I appreciate the points around approximately 1,000 people who are served by the Braemar weather station with regard to cold weather payments. Yeah, I appreciate the points around that. However, of course, we have made a policy decision here to also expand the amount of people that are going to receive support in a reliable way to approximately 400,000 people. So a significantly higher amount of people who receive support who also experience cold weather, perhaps not to the same extreme, but certainly do experience the need for additional heating costs. And that's the policy decision that we have made and are asking committee to approve today.
Thank you, Minister. I take that on board, but it does seem a very much process argument rather than people who are living these conditions, and I think that's concerning.
I don't see how that is the case.
Well, these communities which are facing these temperatures now would be receiving payments within 2 weeks under the old system. It's February now that they will receive one payment of £50. So I think that's quite clear that a data scan would be in a better place without this under the DWP current system.
I think that's a balance because I can appreciate that you could argue that a smaller number of people would be better off under the cold weather payment, but then of course over 200,000 people are going to receive support from the winter heating payment that wouldn't have received that under the cold weather payment. So.
And these are people obviously in the coldest communities in Scotland. I think maybe there could have been more flexibility to take that into account now rather than future years. Now, the Scottish Government told SCoS that it may take a few weeks in February to actually process these payments. Can I ask, will the eligible recipients receive their payments before the end of February? Is that now guaranteed?
I'm going to bring Angela in at this point. Of course, contingent on receiving the data scan from the DWP and that data being in order and the processes being initiated and in the way that we intend, all of that considered, we will aim to pay everyone as quickly as possible within February, but I cannot guarantee that everyone will receive the benefit within February, but that is certainly our intention, to get the support to people as quickly as we can. Angela, do you want to say a bit more about that, please?
Yes, thanks, Minister. Yeah, we will receive the data, as Minister has described, from the DWP at the end of January. Following our assurance of the data, we will then start making the payments in batches. That's to allow, first of all, a safe and secure transition of that data into the automatic payment system so that we get as many people paid automatically as possible. But also, as Minister has already mentioned, taking into account Social Security Scotland and the capacity that they will have to handle processing of that data and queries and comments from our client group. So we want to make sure that we are able across the piece within Social Security Scotland and our technical delivery to be able to get those payments out as quickly as possible. So they will start from February in those batches and we will continue to do that as quickly as possible.
Thanks, Angela. And just on the previous points that Mr Briggs made, I would just emphasise as well just those who are requiring a bit of extra support to please and engage with the Fuel Insecurity Fund, which of course we've doubled in the Home Heating Support Fund. We want people to get support if they're entitled to it. Thank you
for that. Just before I hand back, Convener, I think it might be important if the Minister leaves this meeting to write to these communities specifically with that information. People might not be aware of that, so I think it would be useful, especially the four postcode areas we're talking about, to make sure households are aware of that.
It's not in my gift to write to communities in that way. Ministers are not able to write to individual households in that regard.
You can liaise with the councils,
certainly the Scottish Government liaises with local authorities on these matters regularly, and of course keen to support both those local authorities and local members to raise awareness of what supports them. And I appreciate Mr Briggs's the context of Mr Briggs's constructive suggestion. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Before I move on to questions from Jeremy Balfour, we are running slightly behind time. I was going to ask the Minister if you'd be able to grant us an extra 15 minutes just to get through the best of our questions. Thank you. We've had members have had a lot of questions this morning, obviously. So I'll move on to Jeremy Balfour. Could you take us into theme four as well? It's yourself for that too.
Yeah, thank you, Cathy. I am slightly concerned by that last answer to Mr Briggs, because I didn't hear from either yourself or from the official a guarantee that these payments will be made in February. And we have seen slippage in other payments by Social Security Scotland already. And I'm just wondering, you said you've had very, or certainly officer-led, you don't seem to have engaged with DWP, but with officers and with officials, you said there's been a good relationship with DWP. Why are we waiting to the end of January to get this information? Why are we not getting it now or at the beginning of January so that we can guarantee these payments will be made in February? Why are we waiting to the end of the month?
Well, I think that's a very good question, Mr Balfour, and that's certainly, as I said, we requested the data from DWP from early January in order to give us more time to make sure that we could deliver the benefit as quickly as possible. However, DWP have relayed to DWP officials have relayed to my officials that because of the other demands on the DWP with the cost of living payments, they were only able to guarantee us the scan by the end of January. So we're grateful to them that they have guaranteed that and committed to giving us the scan by the end of January, but we did wish for it earlier. But we also appreciate the demands on them. And as Angela has articulated, once we have the data scan, agency will work as hard and as proactively as it can to get payments out to people as quickly as possible in a safe and secure way. I have said that I cannot guarantee that everyone will get their payment in February, but what I can guarantee is that we will seek to get payments to people as quickly as possible and to as many people as possible in February.
And then can I then, just again, just push on that, have you had discussions with your ministerial colleagues in London about this transfer of information? Have you discussed this with your counterpart within DWP?
Yes, of course, there's been a number of ministerial changes at UK level. The winter heating payment was, as far as I can recall, an issue that I discussed at points with Ms Smith in previous bilaterals, but the issue of data is something that I did not discuss with her because the concerns around us not getting it until late January hadn't emerged at that point. But I had a very helpful bilateral with Mr Persglove this week, who is the new minister, and grateful to him and his officials for their confirmation during that bilateral that we will receive the data scan on the 31st of January as agreed.
Thank you. If I can move on, as I'm conscious of time, just to two questions around the next area. You may not have this information to hand, Minister, so I'm happy if you want to write to us. And that is, you helpfully say that there are other benefits available. You mentioned several of them. Do you have a number of people, this will be the only winter payment they will receive, so they're not entitled, maybe the older people, so not entitled to any of the kind of benefits around children. Do you have a breakdown of this is the only payment that they will receive in regard to winter heating?
I don't have that data to hand. We can take that away as an action to get back to the member and the committee on. I mean, of course, I would point out that, of course, there will be benefits that they will be receiving also from the UK government in this situation too. So, an additional.
I appreciate it. Just whether we could give that would be helpful. Thank you. My final question, Minister, and I think you and I have discussed this both when you were on committee and also since you've been Minister, and that is your government's view on extending the child winter heating assistance to include disabled adults as well, because obviously there are many adults who are in receipt of some kind of award either mobility or care, but won't receive this winter heating payment. They will often be at home more and will have higher heating costs. Is there any policy intention to include this in disabled adults? I appreciate not this year, but maybe in next year, or is it something the government would like to get to in the next 2 or 3 years?
Excuse me. I'm interested to see the committee's engagement on this point. I mean, of course, child winter heating assistance was delivering on a 2016 SNP manifesto commitment to extend the eligibility for the winter fuel payment to families with children in receipt of the highest care component of disability living allowance. Obviously, today we're talking about introducing winter heating payment, which, of course, is about supporting those on low incomes who are most vulnerable, including adults with disabilities. This will be followed, as members know, by the introduction of pension age winter payment in 2024, replacing winter fuel payments. So we have to deliver that in the period ahead. And how we continue to support both disabled children and disabled adults through the social security system is a point that we're obviously all concerned about and want to provide support where we can. In terms of the direct question of extending child winter heating assistance to include disabled adults, that isn't something we've considered directly at this juncture, but I appreciate the committee's interest in the matter.
Thank you, Minister. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. For our last theme, I'll move to questions from Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Convener. We've heard this morning about the support that you've put in place for people across Scotland. And of course, we welcome the payments that are available here. And we'll all do what we can to make sure people access them through the communication of this. But ultimately, Energy Action Scotland, and I agree with them, said that it is like a finger in a dam. And so when it comes to fuel poverty, we really are falling short for too many people in Scotland. They estimate that the financial support that has been described, a lot of which this morning, including changes to benefits in Social Security Scotland, that even with all of that, one in three households in Scotland will be in fuel poverty by April next year, and one in four in extreme fuel poverty. They've gone on to say that higher costs with an inadequate financial support will lead to an increase in excess winter mortality. And of the Scottish Government payments, they say that none recover a position for any household. The Government, through its Fuel and Security Fund, they go on to say, has provided crisis payments to a small number of households, important for those who receive them, but insufficient. And they conclude that the support that's been available is a patchwork, with one-off payments being normalised and targeting being poor. So can the Minister commit now to reviewing the fuel payments landscape in Scotland to help struggling families today?
Just in terms of that last question, how would you envisage that taking place? Just for so I'm absolutely clear on what you're asking, Ms. Duncan-Glancy.
I think it's clear that none of the payments that you've described this morning have addressed the real fuel insecurity and poverty that people across Scotland are experiencing. I was going to also mention the child winter heating payment issue that Jeremy Balfour, my colleague, has mentioned. A number of disabled people, regardless of their age or their level of impairment, are having to use more heating now than before. So they are disproportionately impacted by this. But the reality is, what we've heard in this committee and what people have told us in our constituencies is that they don't have enough money to get by, and none of what we're doing in Scotland is getting there. It's like a finger in a dam, as we've been told. So will you be able to commit to reviewing this landscape very, very quickly and starting to really address the fuel poverty that people in Scotland are going to experience?
I thank the member for raising these important points, and of course these are considerations that myself and ministerial colleagues are engaged in, and we are seeking, with the mechanisms and resources that we have, the limited resources within a largely fixed budget, to provide additional support to people. And I appreciate you recognise that in your question. We will always seek to consider what more we can do, but also with mindfulness around how there are demands on other aspects of the public sector. There's strong demand across the board in terms of what people are needing during this cost of living crisis. We have provided a significant amount of extra support over and above what we have from the UK government in terms of the block grant adjustment for our social security, approximately around £500 million, £460 million in the financial year that we're in. And we, you know, I think the evidence of creating the child winter heating assistance benefit, the evidence of seeking to provide this benefit of winter heating assistance to more households, the evidence of introducing the Scottish Child Payment and increasing it by 150% shows that the Scottish Government is doing what it can to provide additional support. But we appreciate that people are really under a significant challenge at the moment, and we absolutely recognise that and are working to identify resource where we can to support people in extra ways. And of course, when it comes to addressing fuel poverty, there are wider aspects around people's dwellings and energy efficiency, and I know there was a lot of discussion on these matters, quite understandably, in the evidence you took last week, and I would encourage engagement with my ministerial colleague, Mr. Harvey, and I'm sure he would be interested to come back and speak to the committee on what the government is undertaking in that regard to help people with their heating costs, with their dwellings, and how we reduce energy consumption in order to help people with these cost pressures as well.
Thank you. I have no other questions on this. Thanks.
Thank you. I move now to questions from Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. It follows on from the line of questioning Jeremy Balfour had. I wanted to raise, and the Minister's, I'm sure, aware of Marie Curie's campaign with regards to Scottish Government looking to extend eligibility for the assistance to terminally ill people, and to make sure that that's also including people under the age of 65. So I just wondered where the Scottish Government were on that, and if that's something, given what he's outlined to committee about potential reforms and changes, government are mindful to take forward.
First of all, I thank Mr. Briggs for raising this issue and for his work in this area. And I know that over the course of the last year, there have been a number of different areas in which Mr. Briggs has questioned the matter of terminal illness, and perhaps we can arrange a meeting in 2023 to discuss these issues more roundly. I think that would be helpful. Of course, we all want to make sure as much as we can that as we can do it, that no terminally ill person should have to worry about their finances in such a difficult time. And of course, as a government, we recognise the specific requirements of those living with life-limiting conditions, and the call for greater support. However, there's also consideration around whether winter heating payment is the correct vehicle for extending provision in those circumstances. It is already, of course, the case that some people who receive disability benefit in relation to their terminal illness may already be eligible to receive a winter heating payment through entitlement to one of the qualifying low-income benefits and relevant premiums. And of course, more generally, we have introduced a range of support measures for terminally ill people and their carers. For instance, in introducing our Scottish disability benefits, as members know, we have changed the definition of terminal illness to be more sympathetic to enable people to access the social security support we want them to receive. And we have done this by removing any time requirement from our definition of terminal illness in Scotland, which of course allows child disability payment and adult disability payment to provide people who are terminally ill with fast-tracked access to financial assistance at the highest rates they're entitled to, ensuring that accessing financial support for them is as straightforward as possible. And our person-centred approach to child disability payment and adult disability payment relies on the judgment of clinicians, as I said, rather than fixed periods of life expectancy. So any potential improvements, including extension of the eligibility criteria, will be considered once this new benefit of winter heating payment is being delivered and its initial evaluation is complete. So I thank Mr. Briggs for raising it, and also, as I said, more generally, would be happy to meet with him on issues surrounding terminal illness in the new year.
Thank you, Minister. That would be very helpful. And this week I met with Carolyn Hunter, who the Minister will be aware of, who very much highlighted the 5,000 families across Scotland who have children who have equipment at home, which is seeing their energy bills go up. Now, I know this isn't directly for this assistance, but it's also something I'm quite keen to progress and look to do a round table next year with cross-party round table on. So I hope the Minister happy to take up that meeting, and hopefully these things can be discussed going forward, because I think, given the energy cost, it's an important issue to try to look towards a solution as well.
And I appreciate the cost facing those households. I hope that the delivery of child winter heating assistance and the changes that we've made in terms of increasing the amount of people last year, increasing the amount of people who were eligible for that, has helped. But appreciate the challenges for these households.
Yep. Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you very much. We just have one final question from Deputy Convener Emma Roddick to finish us off.
Thank you, Convener. I do want to go back, first of all, to the timeline issue, because the Minister did touch on the data. Could he outline, firstly, what preparations are taking place at Social Security Scotland in order to be ready to make the payments in February, and how reliance on DWP for that data adds complexity to the delivery?
Thank you. I will bring in Angela in a moment, just to talk practically around from an agency perspective. But yes, the scan is absolutely essential to being able to deliver this benefit, because the eligibility criteria, as members will see in the regs, is based upon reserved benefits and to a large extent to a full extent, rather. So we absolutely have to have that scan in order to deliver the benefit. Significant preparation has been undertaken to date and will be undertaken over the weeks ahead and until we receive that scan. And Angela, that would probably be a good time to bring you in just to illuminate on that a little more. Thanks.
Yes, thanks, Minister. The data, once we've received it, as we've discussed previously, has a period of assurance. That's to make sure that we can actually put the data into the system and make as many automatic payments as possible. In conjunction with that as well, our agency colleagues have been identified and are being trained currently to assist with processing of any cases that are not able to progress through the automatic route, and also to take any questions from clients in relation to those payments that are about to be made to them all.
Thank you. And finally, we did hear last week about how those with the highest need for help paying energy bills are affected by other issues like needing energy efficiency measures in their home and improvements in the wider context of UK energy policy. So, could the Minister just outline how he's working with other portfolios in government to make sure that investment to reduce the need for social security is going on?
Absolutely, and as part of the net zero agenda, as well as the Tackling Child Poverty national mission that the government has, of course, ministers along with partners are working collegiately on how do we reduce demand, how do we improve quality of people's dwellings and energy efficiency within them, my cabinet secretary Shona Robertson, of course, social security and housing within her remit, and the engagement between the work of Mr. Harvey and the work of Social Security Scotland, and how that all comes together to help reduce both demand for energy and also demand for social security is absolutely part of the focus of those two of the main pillars of the government's work, which are the net zero agenda and the mission to tackle poverty and child poverty in particular. I would say as well, of course, that it's about efficiency of housing, but also cost of housing. Of course, the government has, by investing capital in a significantly significantly more social housing than anywhere else in the UK, means that costs are lower for people, which means that their costs overall are reduced, is an important aspect of what the government has delivered in recent years, in fact, over the last decade. But also the recent action that the government and the parliament have taken on rents, I think, is important to consider within this overall scenario as well.
Thank you very much. That brings us to a close on that agenda item, and I thank the Minister for giving us that extra time there. So we'll move on to agenda item 3, which is the formal consideration of motion S6M06818, that the Social Justice and Social Security Committee recommends that the Winter Heating Assistance Low Income Scotland Regulations Draft 2023 be approved. I invite the Minister to speak to and move the motion.
I would refer members to my opening statement and the discussion we've had, and I would urge colleagues to pass the motion and move it in my name.
Thank you very much, Minister. I now invite contributions from members, and I see Jeremy Balfour would like to come in.
Thank you, Convener. And again, can I thank the Minister for his answers today? I mean, I think there's clearly mixed views around this benefit. And in regard to how it has been handled and how it has been implemented. And although the Minister has given some helpful answers today, I'm not sure he's actually grasped the disappointment that has been amongst many people about how this new benefit has been implemented. Clearly, it is the only thing on the table, and so I won't be voting against it this morning, but I won't be supporting it either. I will be abstaining, because actually I think the government could have done a lot better on this. And I think what we need to say to Scottish Government is we understand that this will happen hopefully in February, but going forward we need to see new regulations which actually address some of the issues that have come up in questions today. As the Minister has pointed out, this is a new system. This is a new benefit created by the powers within this own Scottish Parliament. And I do find it slightly strange that we have a system which has been designed which fails in one of the policy objectives of the Scottish Government, which they put down in writing, and that was to leave no one behind. And however the Minister wants to argue it, and as a fine lawyer he has argued it very well, the fact is there are people going to be left behind by this new system, particularly around Braemar and the surrounding areas of the Highlands. Now, I don't know what discussions took place within Scottish Government, and I appreciate the Minister wasn't involved in those, it was his predecessors. But to go from a system that wasn't working perhaps particularly well, to go to a system now that isn't working particularly well, seems to me a rather odd situation. Or why weren't we able to sit down and come up with a scheme that would maybe include more people and does include more people, but at the same time protects those who are the most vulnerable in regard to cold temperatures in Scotland? There will be people in other parts of the United Kingdom in the next couple of weeks that will be getting money from DWP, while residents in Braemar are hoping that we might get £50 in February. And that seems to me not treating people with dignity and respect. Absolutely.
I would just say that I appreciate the argument that the member is making. I would just state that people who are entitled to winter heating payment won't need to hope they will get it. And that is the different nature of the benefit, in that it will be delivered safely and securely to those who are entitled and will not rely on weather conditions.
Well, actually, with respect, Minister, that's not what you said this morning. You said that you hope that we will get it in February, but you weren't willing to guarantee that we will get it in February. And that seems to me, again, a failing within the system. Now, again, I appreciate it was a lot of this work was done before the Minister came into place, but I would have thought with an issue of this importance in regard getting the information from DWP, that at some point over the last few months, not just like this week, but actually July, August, September, the Minister would have picked up the telephone to his counterpart in London and said, actually, can you make this more of a priority? I appreciate we've got, I'll maybe just push on for a moment. I'm pleased that we've got a good relationship between DWP, Scottish Government, Social Security Scotland, but actually, could you get this information to us 2 or 3 weeks early?
Would the member take an intervention at that point? Yeah. I've just asked the member to be mindful, of course, of the turmoil that the UK Government was in through the winter months and the challenging circumstances that created for intergovernmental engagement, and also with regard to new ministers being appointed and then brought up to speed within their various departments. So I can assure you that my officials pressed on a regular basis on the need that we would prefer the data earlier and would need the data in order to deliver the benefit. But we have also been sensitive to and mindful of the pressures on DWP in terms of delivering their cost of living support. So I would just want to be absolutely clear that the Scottish Government has made the case strongly that we would have preferred the data at an earlier juncture, but also we have been respectful of our SNP colleague, our DWP colleagues rather, of the need, the demands on them, and we have come to an agreement, and we are grateful to them for committing strongly that they will give us the data we need on the 31st of January.
I appreciate that, Minister, but again, my point is, you didn't pick up the phone, and there was opportunity. That is a point. You didn't pick up your phone. This obviously wasn't seen as a priority for yourself. No, I think I'll move on, if that's okay, because I'm conscious of time, but you need to move on to other things. The final point I want to make is, if I was sitting here a few years ago with the Minister when he was on the committee, and DWP had said, well, we hope to get the payment by February, but actually we can't guarantee that. It might be March before we get it. There would have been an outrage, rightly so, from the committee. But yet, it seems to be that this committee is quite happy to say, well, maybe February, maybe March, let's just wait and see. And I think we are treating two systems completely differently. And I do think it is time that the Minister took responsibility. We are seeing payments not happening on time. We're seeing that on Twitter. We're seeing people going on Twitter saying, I haven't received it then, I haven't received it when I should have. And it's now time for Social Security Scotland to deliver this. And I would have hoped the Minister would have been able to be a bit more positive in regard to this payment being made to everyone in February. So I am asking the Minister to go away with his officials and see if he can come up with something better for next year. We will vote. We won't vote against it, because clearly that would just leave people even worse off. But I'm not sure this is what we envisage when we hope for new benefits coming out of Scottish Government. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Jeremy. I now have some comments from Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Convener. And I thank the Minister and his officials for answering the questions this morning. I'm afraid I don't accept that this is better simply because it's reliable. All people can rely on is a payment that pays for 6 days' heat, £1 a week, a finger in a dam, as Energy Action Scotland have called it, and not even until February, which is far too late. So no, I don't think the alternative that we have here in front of us is acceptable. My constituents in Glasgow, I believe, will be aghast at the fact that all they're getting to deal with the fuel poverty they're in is £1 a week. And I agree with a constituent from Glasgow who I know has written to both the Minister and I and said, and I share this, that I am aghast that this ill-conceived benefit has been launched. And so I'm afraid, Minister and Convener, on that basis, I can't support the motion in front of us, and I will abstain and hope that the Government will reconsider its approach. Yes.
Thank Pam Duncan-Glancy for taking an intervention. I appreciate her stated view that she does not believe that the £50 is a high enough figure. But would she appreciate that this cold weather payment, winter heating payment, will deliver more support for her constituents than the cold weather payment did?
Well, first of all, I'm not sure if the Minister has been outside in Glasgow in the last few days, and we are heading for a very, very cold period. So I think we'll wait and see what happens with the weather. But I think what's also important is that regardless of that, what you're offering people in Glasgow, 36% of whom are living in fuel poverty just now, £1 a week. And I don't think anyone who looks at this offer from the Scottish Government can look at that and think you had an opportunity to redesign a fuel payment, a winter heating allowance that would genuinely have the impact, could genuinely have had an impact on fuel poverty in Scotland. And this is what's been done. And I don't think they'll accept that. I will.
On the basis of the last 10 years, the evidence shows that a winter heating payment will provide more assistance mm-hmm. than cold weather payments have and would have if they'd continued on average. But does Pam Duncan Glancy also welcome that by creating this new benefit, we are creating the framework that should the Scottish Government be able to finance a higher payment in a future financial year, that the mechanism is now there that would provide more support to her constituents in Glasgow than would have been the case under the cold weather payment system?
I accept that the technical detail that the Minister has set out, which says there is a mechanism there, I accept that there is a mechanism there. I don't believe on the basis of what I've seen since I've been in this place since May 2021 that commitments such as that have ever come to fruition in this time. So I'll wait and see, and I'll hope that those mechanisms that are in the regulations will be used to support the people who live in Glasgow. And I take the point about the average weather in the city over the last 10 years. But I would also say that I shared the concerns about the way in which the data is collected and the weather stations it's collected from. The point I made is that we had an opportunity to change the whole way that we did this in Scotland. And I believe the offer in front of people of Scotland is insufficient and will leave thousands of families freezing this winter. And, Convener, I will abstain on this motion for all of those reasons. Thank you.
Thank you, Pam. Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Convener. I wanted to address firstly, because a few colleagues have talked about the coldest parts of Scotland missing out and often referring to my region, the Highlands and Islands. And I think we do need to be clear that cold weather payments are not going to the coldest places in Scotland. They're certainly not going to the coldest homes in Scotland. They are going to the coldest weather stations. And the Minister did address the fact that wind chill isn't measured, 6 days of -2 isn't going to trigger a payment and so on. The people who struggle most with energy bills in my region are in the Western Isles, they're in the Northern Isles and areas of the Highlands. They have not been getting cold weather payments and they are going to get £50 this winter.
Will the member take notice?
Yes, I will.
Does the member think that £1 a week is sufficient to address that?
I thought that is what Pam Duncan Glancy was going to say, and it's exactly what I'm about to address, because is it going to go far? No. But I think we need to be clear that energy doesn't need to cost this much. I would much prefer that the UK government take some action on energy companies instead of allowing them to take advantage of this situation and bankroll their eye-watering profits. And if we're going to sit and listen to criticism today that there's not enough social security going on to the problem, then we need to at least acknowledge the cause. Yes.
On that basis, then, would the member support my colleagues in Westminster's argument that we should be having a proper windfall tax on those energy companies that has no loopholes?
Yes, I would support a windfall tax and a stronger one than has been proposed already. Yes.
Would she support then, if that's the case, of the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament having the powers to do so, which aren't reserved in this Parliament, but down south?
That would be the ideal scenario. And Pam Duncan Glancy mentioned a finger in a dam, but I think we need to at least ask why there is a flood. More money is going to be spent on this scheme than was on cold weather payments. More of my constituents are going to benefit from it. More of hers are. It's not the only measure aimed at supporting people through winter. There's fuel insecurity, the island's cost crisis funds, other benefits being delivered by Social Security Scotland. So just to make clear that people in receipt of this are not just going to receive £50. That's £50 more as a winter uplift of sorts. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Emma Roddick. We'll move now to James Dornan online.
Thank you, Convener. Convener, a couple of things. Emma's raised a few of the points that I was going to raise. I've been an opposition politician. I was a councillor for a number of years in Glasgow, and I understand why Jeremy and Pam are looking for a reason not to support this, to abstain on it. Jeremy's reason seems to be that the minister never made a phone call. Pam seems to be that her constituents are now getting extra money than they would have been before, so she's going to abstain. That doesn't make any sense to me whatsoever. This is not an ideal policy, but it's the best policy that we were going to get with the fixed budget that we already have, and I would have liked to have seen the committee vote as one to support it.
If you want to put your mic on to...
Sorry. Would you remember taking an intervention?
Yes, of course I will, Jeremy.
Do you recognise that this is a new system devised by the Scottish Government? They've had a number of years to devise a scheme. Do you believe this is the best scheme that could have been devised by Scottish Government to cover everybody in Scotland, not just your constituents in Glasgow?
I can't say that for sure it is, because I haven't been involved in the discussions. But what I do know is that it's better than we had previously. It doesn't deserve the criticism that it's been getting from some members of the committee just now, when we could be saying that we think it could be improved. We'll be keeping an eye on it for next year and future years, but we're working to a very tight, a strict timetable. And the other thing is...
Will the member take an intervention on that point?
February, just one second, Pam. You can't make guarantees about February if you're not getting the detail to the 31st of January. It's just not feasible to be able to make a promise such as that. Yes, Pam, of course.
I thank the member for taking the intervention. And I take the point about the data being available, and I sincerely hope that it will be, given what we've heard about the February payment being already too late. But I don't accept that we're having to rush this through. We've had powers over social security in Scotland for a significant number of years now. And here we are in a situation where we've got an opportunity to redesign a benefit, and yet again we've fallen short.
Right, OK. Where does this extra money come from? Because what we're talking about is, you're talking about pound a week, finger in the dam, using all the phrases from the witnesses last week, and that's fair. But where does this extra money come from? This is extra money that's come from the Scottish Government to pay 200,000 people more than were getting paid before. And I accept that there are some losers in this, potential losers, surely, but we can see that the best is being done under the circumstances that we have.
Thank you, James. I have contributions left from Miles Briggs, and to be followed by Paul McLennan.
Thank you, Convener. And I think just to pick up the point James Dornan just made there, the Government had said that there wouldn't be losers. There clearly are going to be. And I'm concerned, and I think the discussions we've been trying to have as a committee on this is leaving many parts of rural Scotland who currently benefit because of that extra cold weather they experience behind, and they will be financially worse off. And I think that isn't a system we should have been seeing developed, and that could have been corrected before now. And I am concerned what that means for some low-income families living in communities like Braemar and Aviemore and across rural Scotland, especially the weather which we've seen. And I think that's a problem which should have been fixed. And I think the committee have expressed that frustration, Minister, today, that we are putting in place this system, which, yes, I accept is moving towards a universal payment system for people, but is not taking into account that previous targeted support based on the coldest weather communities across Scotland often do experience. So that's not acceptable. I hope the Minister takes on board the debate we've had this morning in terms of these changes, that support will be actually provided, and the additional support people will be made aware of, which I think many people will not be aware of, or how they apply for that, not necessarily aware how to do that. And that the Government commit to come back as soon as possible to try to fix this and put in place a better system. Because I think all of us on this committee hoped and wanted to see a better system put in place, and this doesn't feel like that's lived up to that expectation. And so, like Jeremy Balfour has said, I won't vote against these, but I'll be abstaining today because I don't think we should be approving this system as it stands.
Paul McLennan.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I think we have to sometimes take a wee step back from some of the discussions we have and look at the context of the discussion. 400,000 people getting benefit as against 185,000. automatically. £8.3 million was the estimated spend, now £20 million. So that's the first context. I think we've also got to look at the part of the wider benefit context that's been mentioned as well. The payment we're talking about today is obviously part of it. We mentioned about the Scottish Government looking at child payment and other benefits that are brought forward. We heard around about the DWP talking about pension tax credits. Now, I understand about a quarter to a third of people who are entitled to benefit pension tax credits don't claim it. Emma Roddick touched on the point of energy costs. You know, in energy-rich Scotland, we face some of the highest energy costs in the UK, if not in Europe. So, first and foremost, we need we need the powers to tackle this first and foremost. I'll take the intervention at this stage. But
no, thank you. The member represents a very rural part of Scotland. Mm-hmm. It hasn't triggered payments necessarily to the same extent as communities north. Would he want to see if his community is losing out in a way that we don't have Aberdeenshire members here, for example, on this committee? But what this will do, and where we were led to believe that no one would lose out, this will see communities lose out. And why hasn't the government taken that on board?
I've looked at my own areas in terms of that, and I know that that doesn't impacted on that particular regard. I think the fact that it's automatic and it goes to more people is an important point. And, you know, just a few weeks ago, we were talking about, you know, a fixed budget. We operate within a fixed budget. And, of course, we'd like to pay more. But we operate within a fixed budget. Only a few weeks ago, this committee voted against additional borrowing powers in the budget scrutiny, which would give us that opportunity to have demand-led services and poor money towards that, such as the payment. So, you know, we need to look at that in terms of this. And the thing, as I said, for me, is that the key thing is 400,000 people as against 185, £8.3 million we spent previously, £20 million this pound. It's not a perfect scheme. It's part of an overall package, but we need to look at the overall causes of why energy costs in Scotland are so high. We need the powers to deal with this in Scotland. So I'll be supporting the legislation this morning. Thank you.
Thank you, and thank members for all contributions. I will now invite the Minister to sum up and respond to the debate.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, colleagues. And I would want to thank all colleagues for the discussion we've had today and for the evidence that the committee heard last week and the constructive way in which it's been given. There are several parts of the contributions that I would seek to challenge, and I've of course done that in interventions, and I appreciate the time constraints and won't dwell on them all. I would like, however, to just pick up on the point that Mr. Balfour made about engagement with the UK government. I mean, I think it's completely unfair and unreasonable to challenge ministerial engagement with the UK government during the period that we've been through, where there's been such turmoil at ministerial level in the UK government with changes. I can assure Mr. Balfour and the committee and Parliament that my officials engaged regularly with UK government counterparts on the need for us to receive a scan in good time. And we came to an agreement on that, and we're grateful to DWP for that. I took the two opportunities I've had to have a conversation with my new ministerial counterpart to raise this point. But of course, he has only been in post for a number of weeks. And the scenario in the summer made ministerial engagement very challenging. So just want to assure the committee that I do undertake engagement with ministerial colleagues when I can, in a very serious way, to press the issues of concern to the people of Scotland and to make sure that we deliver Social Security in Scotland safely and securely. On the wider points, as I've set out in my opening statement and throughout today's discussion, the changes that we're making today are going to help significantly more people, tens of thousands of more people, on a reliable basis. People will be able to rely on winter heating payment from the Scottish Government. They will be able to budget knowing that it's coming. It will not be dependent on weather conditions and will therefore be a part of, along with other support, helping people in situations of fuel poverty and financial challenge. Certainly.
I'm grateful it's guaranteed, because it's not guaranteed. If DWP were saying we'll try to get a payment to you, but we might be several weeks late, would that be acceptable? And if it's not acceptable for DWP, why is it acceptable for Social Security Scotland?
It is guaranteed that winter heating payment will be paid to people every year and will not be dependent on weather conditions. We have gone through the points around delivery within the month of February, and I have made a strong commitment that we will seek to and do what we can to get payment to people within the month of February. And that is our ambition and our strong ambition and our determination and the commitment of Angela Keane and all of her team at Social Security Scotland. We will do what we can to get that payment to people as quickly as possible. But delivering to 400,000 people is a significant amount of people, and we want to make sure we get that support to them. And also, the financial commitment of the Scottish Government is, of course, higher at £20 million than the average average of £8.3 million spent on cold weather payments. So again, with regard to this benefit, we are spending more than would have been the case under the UK system. So I thank members for their constructive engagement today. I urge Parliament to put the committee to pass these regulations so that we can deliver winter heating payment for around 400,000 people in Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. The question is that motion S6M06818 in the name of Ben McPherson, MSP, be approved. Are we all agreed? We are not all agreed, so we will move to a division. The choices are for, against, or abstain. So we will proceed with the vote on a roll call basis. In alphabetical order, and move to Jeremy Balfour first.
Abstain, Convener.
Thank you. Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Abstain as well.
Faisal Chowdhury.
Convener, abstain.
James Dornan.
For, Convener.
Pam Duncan Glancy.
Abstain, Convener.
Paul McLennan.
For, Convener.
And my vote is for. Oh, sorry, I've missed the Deputy Convener. Deputy Convener Emma Roddick.
I would like to vote for the motion. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. And my vote is for. As there is a tie as Convener, I have a further casting vote.
Which four has changed?
Oh, I'm so sorry. This is my first time doing a vote like this, so forgive my mistakes. Okay, so we are agreed. The motion is passed. The committee... Yes.
Just for the record, I would like to note that I will be seeking to bring these regulations to the main chamber when we come after recess, so that the whole chamber can consider whether these regulations are appropriate or not.
Thank you for that, Jeremy Balfour. The committee will report on the outcome of this instrument in due course. I invite the committee to delegate authority to me as convener to approve a draft of the report for publication. Yes. Thank you, Minister, and thank you to your officials for attending this morning, and I now close the meeting.